Hello? Is this thing on? Okay. Welcome to what is my very first YouTube video ever. And hopefully the start of a bit of a series of video builds. Going right through from the very basics, showing you all the steps, explaining a bit about what I'm doing, and hopefully providing a little entertainment. So the first build that I'm going to be doing is this. It's actually the first land vehicle I will ever have made. I've kind of been exclusively working on planes before. It's a German light armoured car from the war. That is the Second World War. And it became famous for a little while, if you remember the series Ala Lo, as Lieutenant Gruber's little tank in that show. It's a Tamiya kit, so it's really nice quality. I still don't know whether it's pronounced Tamiya or Tamiya or Argoflage, but, well, I'll probably be using any of those. The plastic's really good quality, there's a lot of detail, the fit's really nice, but this is starting to show its age a little bit now, so there is a little bit of flash on it that's going to need trimming off, and a little bit of panel lines, mould lines. So, you know, that's something I'll be getting onto over the course of it, and I'm not going to make you sit and watch me take mould lines off every single piece of this, but give a little bit of a demonstration. This is a slight update of the kit, which includes, as you see there, photo etch. There we go. That's for the kind of grill around the top. It's got a sort of hood on it. And a turned aluminium gun barrel, which is lovely. Means there's not going to be any nasty seam lines down the middle of that. And it also includes with it pieces to make some oil drums and a bunch of jerry cans, which is going to be nice for any kind of dioramas you want. Also in the box, some string for making the tow rope on the front, and the transfers, most of which we won't be using because I'm not building this straight out of the box. I'm actually, like all of the models I'm making at the moment, I'm going to be making a different paint scheme, a fictional paint scheme, based on the Mass Effect series of video games. This being a land vehicle, and kind of quite nippy with a big gun and a little gun in the top of it, is going to represent the M35 Mako from the games, which looks like this. There you go, so we can take a quick look at the plastic in the kit. We've got the top and bottom sections. You can see there's some nice moulded detail in the top there of grills and such like. A lot of these have little sections that go on afterwards and attach on. So this doesn't look very detailed now, but it'll turn into a lovely, lovely kit later on. There's the bottom. You can see there's a lot of nice moulded detail there, and there's going to be more attached on very shortly. The wheels are nice and detailed. They've got a lovely tread pattern there, which I'm going to be taking great pleasure in making all muddy and dirty and dusty. What else we got? Here's the main cannon and machine gun. That's a 20mm cannon there, same kind as they had in the Wings of Spitfires and so forth, firing 2cm wide explosive shells. And there's a machine gun. Next to it, there's a spare tire on the side there. There's a nice kind of fabric, leathery kind of texture on that. Don't know how well you can see that. This sprue has the frames for the top. It's also got a pilot figure. We're not going to be using him. Mud guards, and there's the top of the turret. Now this has an open turret on the top, which is covered by, as I mentioned before, this grill. And then the final sprue has the a lot of the undercarriage, the drive shaft, and some bits like that. going to be doing this pretty much out of the box in terms of no scratch building, no aftermarket parts. What I am going to do is introduce a little bit of battle damage for a couple of reasons, which I'll go into later. Not loads and loads, and it's going to be fairly heavily weathered in the paint scheme. Because it's a working fighting tank in the game. It takes a lot of batter, it takes a lot of hammer. So, without further ado, let's get into it. So we've got the parts we need for the first step in the instructions. We've got the underside of the vehicle. We've got the two doors here. These sections are like side panels and they contain part of the suspension. This little tube that goes across, I don't know exactly what it is. And the final part is the bumper. Is that the front or the back bumper? Can't see for now. I think it's the front bumper. So I've got these little sprue cutters. These are real cheap ones. You can go expensive, but you don't really need to if you're just cutting plastic with them. And they are flush cutters, so they'll go right up to the edge. That said, you still got to make sure that you are not cutting through the part when you do it. And you just snip it off and snip it off there and keep a hole on the part so it doesn't go pinging off into the distance. And there we go. Now, as I mentioned before, these bits do have a little bit of flash on, a bit of a molding line. Now, if I can get it to focus, you can see the mold line. Hopefully along the edge of that part. You can see it along here. If you compare that with this piece, which I've already cleaned up, you can see that molding line is all gone. And if you look further ahead, forward in the instructions, then what you'll see which parts get covered up by other pieces later, which parts you don't need to do. It's like anything else, you don't want to be putting in more effort than you need to. So there's several ways of getting rid of the little extra bits of plastic. You take your knife. If there's a larger bit, you can, brand new knife blade, they're not expensive, use a fresh one. Just run it along and just cut off along the edge there. And that's just cut off that piece. If you've got a mold line going along, like on this, take the blade and hold it roughly at right angles, as if you're going to cut into it like that. Come on, focus. There we go. And you just run it along. And it just scrapes away just that mold line. Makes a bit of a squeaky noise. You can see that's cleaned it right up. Now you are next to each other, the section that's been done and the section that hasn't. Okay, so I'm going to go away and clean all these parts up. And I'll come back to you in a second. Of course, other ways you can work are with a file or a sanding stick. The file, especially, you want to go really super gentle, particularly if you're working on round or cylindrical pieces. This is because it can take quite a bit of material away at once, and you don't want it to end up with a flat edge on the piece that you're doing where you've sanded it away. Sanding sticks, very cheap. All these tools are very cheap. Again, there are expensive versions in model shops, and there are ones that aren't, you know, amazing quality, but they do the job, and they are a lot cheaper. And you can get them on a certain popular shopping website named after a river, and they won't set you back too much money. Sanding sticks, particularly, check out the kind that you can buy in Boots and other chemists like that, which are meant for fingernails. because they quite often have lots of different sides that are designed for, you know, they've got lots of different grains and coarsenesses. That's especially useful if you're trying to get something down really fine and you're iterating through going finer and finer and finer with the grades. Okay, so we're good to go. These are all cleaned up. And the first thing in the instructions is to take these sections and they slot in. Now, this is a Tamiya kit. Everything slots together really nicely and tightly. That's already, that's not coming out, you see. But of course, we've got to glue it in. And for this, I use this stuff. Tamiya extra thin cement. And this is great. It comes with a little applicator brush in the lid. It is very, very thin. You can see it sloshing about in there. And what that means is it gets into cracks and nooks and crannies. It also dries very quickly. So you can put the pieces together like this. And you just brush the glue along the join. And it will seep into that join. Capillary action will take it in there. And it will join them together. And it will dry very quickly. Bearing in mind you shouldn't squeeze too hard on this because polystyrene cement, the way it works is it actually does melt the plastic a little so that it joins together, kind of welds it. And if you squeeze too hard, then it'll squish out the sides a little bit. I've had that happen to me. It's not fun. So before we put this bit on, I'm going to dry fit it. You should always dry fit everything to make sure it fits in properly. That's absolutely fine. That's not quite as tight in as the other side, but it's still a gorgeous, beautiful fit. Before that goes in though, this piece goes in the side. And it specifically says in the instructions, get it the right way around. One end is longer than the other. So this is the right way around. That goes in the side there. Hope you can see this. It marries up to that side. That clicks in together. Like so, and that is now in the middle. So I need to put glue along here, and I'll just put a little glue in each end of that. Again, doesn't need much. So just a little dab here, and a little dab there. That's it. Don't worry about there being excess glue left on the surface. It does just evaporate all the way. You can see there's no... It's a little shiny, but there's no kind of big blobs or anything. So we've got to put the bumper on as well. Now, which way around does that go? That goes in like this. And again, that's just slotting beautifully into place. So we'll just keep it there. Extra thin at each end, and that will go into the join. I'm putting a little extra glue on these ends just to take down a couple of the burrs from where I was sanding it before. These doors are molded separately. They are also molded with a little handle on the inside. Can you see that? That's on the inside. This is the outside, and it has stuff that glues onto it, and there's hinges there, you can see. So you could, with a little bit of scratch building, actually make it so these doors were open. Now, I'm not going to, because you'd need to scratch build an interior then, and that's a little beyond the scope of these kinds of tutorials, at least for now. So I'm just going to glue it straight on. And that will already have stuck, you see. Dries very fast. The other way, if you are worried about getting glue anywhere, of course, there's lots of places that you can glue it from the inside. Messy as you like. So that's the first instruction step. Some of the undercarriage built up. Okay, so we're back and I've cleaned all the mold lines and the flash off the parts for the next step. And staying committed to making this for absolute beginners, I should explain what they are. Mold lines are where the two halves of the injection mold that the plastic is made in, where they come together, the join between them, there's a little raised line around the edge of the part. And quite often they've got clever ways of hiding it. If they put it along the edge of a piece, you can't really see it, but sometimes there's no real way around it and you get it halfway along a piece and it just makes a little raised line. It's unsightly. It looks like plastic. Flash is a problem that you don't really get in kits like this because this is high quality molding, but older Airfix or Revel kits, anything old, generally the more something's produced, the more it's made, the mold starts to break down, it starts to not fit together quite as well. One thing you get there is that the two halves won't quite line up, so if you'll see a round object and it'll be a bit out of shape like that. But the other thing you'll see is flash, which is where the mold line actually sort of extends and there's a little bit of flat plastic edge coming out around the piece, which you've got to trim away and cut off. So there's no flash on this, but I have been trimming away some of the mold lines. Now this is working on more of the undercarriage of the vehicle, so that slots in there. Again, got to dry fit everything. Make sure you dry fit everything before it goes in. So that goes in there. This goes over the top of it and there's a little hole that fits into. Tamiya kits are usually very well engineered, so usually there's no doubt whether you've got something in the right way around or where it's supposed to go. So really tiny piece here, actually. I'm gonna get my tweezers out to handle it. It's a little, what is it, some kind of suspension linkage or drive shaft or something. And I probably don't really strictly need the tweezers to do this, but it's good to show you. This is one of a set of half a dozen sets of tweezers that I got. They were about £2 on the same popular shopping site. And I'm just looking at where this fits, because this isn't supposed to go from one place to another place, but it's way too long for that. So now I'm trying to work out where that is meant to go. What else have we got here? We've got these little hooks and they go neatly into, this is why you look, this is why you dry fit, you see. Go, do you see the little dimple there? Come on, focus. There you are. And they fit in to the side. Okay, I found out what I'd done wrong there. I had got a different size piece because, like an idiot, I don't look at the part numbers. I was taking it off the spot. sprue. The sprue is the name of the plastic frame that all the pieces are attached to. Now that, it's on there perfectly. So, I think we can start getting to attaching all these parts in. Oh, these kind of containers, they're identical, they don't have a particular side they go on, but they attach onto the doors there, like that. Right, let's do that first. Get around the way. So now this piece attaches in here. I'm just looking at where I'm going to put the glue on this. I'm going to put it points here, points here, points here. This is supposed to look like it's all one welded piece, so I'm going to make sure that that stays in nice and tight while I glue it. Alright, that's looking really good. Maybe I'll get some filler on that or sand it down or something when we paint. We'll see once we've got a coat of paint on it what it looks like. Alright, this part goes on next. I'm just going to put a little glue in the hole there for that peg to go in. Now this time, for this little shaft, we're actually going to do it slightly differently. I'm going to use the glue right-handed for a start, but I'm going to put a little bit on the two attachment points and then introduce the part. Looking great. Can you see that? That's the turn of these little hooks, and these are going to be difficult. I'll come back to you once they're done. Okay, welcome back. Got the parts for the next stage cleaned up. All the little hooks are on. I'm glad I checked where I put them, because this armor plate that goes under the front bumper does sort of squeeze snugly around couple of the hooks, and it's quite particular about where it sits. You see? And I'm going to glue it straight into place. Okay, so that armor's on. The other things we have here are the top parts of the suspension. They go on nice and easy. So we'll just put a little glue on these tops here. They're all identical, it doesn't matter which one goes on which. And the final thing is this fabric wrapped spare wheel, which had quite a nasty mold lying around in. I've got it sort of cleaned off, but I'm going to need to see it painted to see if it's going to need any more work. That said, I'm going to glue it on now because it will pull off fairly easily. I was thinking about leaving it off for the time being anyway, because I was thinking about painting it a different color, but actually, seeing it in situ, it's not going to be too hard to mask off or to just take off if I want to do that anyway. So I'm just going to put a little dab of glue in the central divot where it goes, and just let that sit in there. The next stage of the build is the wheels. I don't want to put them on yet because I want to leave them right off until it's absolutely necessary for painting and such like. This is actually the furthest I've ever got into a model without painting anything, and it's one of the reasons I wanted to build this one, as opposed to any of the aircraft I've got. When you're doing an aircraft, you're painting right from the get-go. You're painting the cockpit, you're painting the internals, and you quite often, if you're using aftermarket things like photo etch sets, then you're working with those as well. This is just straight cutting things off and gluing them together to start with. And that's kind of what I wanted to show you first. I hope you've enjoyed this so far, and I hope once I've edited it down, it makes an entertaining video. I'll be doing another one soon, so subscribe and look out for it.